What's up, comrades? Welcome to this week's episode of Red Library, a political education podcast for today's left. We got some new, icy cold motherfucking takes coming your way this week. We are kicking off a new series called the My Gott
Pure Ideology
series here on Red Library. To do that, we got a new comrade in the library, Comrade Marvin, and we're here to start things off right by tackling the big dog himself, Daddy, Fredric Jameson. Comrade Marv is going to lead us through his most recent published book from Verso in 2019 called Allegory and Ideology. This episode could also easily fit into our Real Late Night Philosophy series, our Lost Future series, and who knows what else. We're going to cover some of the core themes, ideas, the analytical framework in Jameson's text, but I think this episode is also just a really great overview of Jameson's project as a whole that spans over multiple works of his, and its relationship to Marxism, its relevance today, and what makes Jameson valuable and worth reading in spite of all the challenges it does bring along with it. We're going to jump right into the episode today since this is a bit of a long one, but in the meantime, please keep supporting Red Library and all the numerous ways we continue to offer to you, our lovely comrade listeners across the globe. If you'd like to support the show materially, head over to Patreon, link is in the show notes, and for as little as $1 per month, or a quarter an episode, you'll get access to all of our exclusive patron-only content, our Discord server where you can hang out, talk with the Red Library crew and other patrons, shit talk, post memes, share ideas, discuss episodes, and so on and so on. Remember to subscribe on iTunes, give us one of those starred reviews, as those are helping us find new listeners and expand the show's reach and base. Follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, all that other jazz, you know what's up. I mean, if this is your first episode, this might be kind of new, but in general, you probably know the deal, and hopefully you've done that stuff already, or if you haven't yet, you're considering it. You're pondering it. You're weighing your options. All right, well, that's about it. I guess there's really not much else to say. So, let's get into it. Comrade Marvin and myself, Comrade Adam, going toe-to-toe with Daddy Jameson. Enjoy. We'll see you afterward. Comrades, welcome to this week's episode of Red Library. We have a new, very special guest in the library, in the very literal library sitting right across from me. I'm going to let him introduce himself.
Comrade Marvin.
Comrade Marvin. That's Comrade Marv, as I'm going to call him throughout our episode today. So you are here to tackle a very, I don't know, like ominous presence, a very ethereal presence on the show. We talk about Jameson almost every episode. We mention him.
Oh, you have?
But no one has tackled a Jameson book yet. So you get the most dubious honor of actually doing a Jameson book for the first time.
Well, very good. Very honored to do that. Because I think we didn't meet over Jameson, but I think we met shopping for books.
We did, actually, yeah. It was in the political theory section at a used bookstore in town, yeah.
The used bookstore. Yeah, that's a really great section. They really do a good job of like maintaining that section. Because it's all like, you know, biographies of Rush Limbaugh and like...
And like all the Glenn Beck books.
That's right.
And then
yeah,
there's
yeah.
just like some Marx thrown in there for good measure.
Marx is like, the way they treat, I don't know, philosophy and theory, which actually I think is an interesting point, is that a lot of this is not really easily placeable in philosophy and theory. And I think the question we actually discussed was at some point post-coloniality. And this,
that's right, yeah.
I think you tackled this on the podcast. But this book includes a response, a very belated response to Ayjad Ahmad, whose book on essentially post-colonial theory that prompted a lot of the debate.
Really?
In 1991,
interesting.
Begins with an essay by Jameson. It prints the essay from 1989 or whatever, and then prints a response to Ahmad. Well, it's not a response, but it prints what Jameson would call a response to Ahmad.
Okay. Well, maybe on that note, why don't we tell everyone what specific Jameson book we're going to do today? So do you want to share that since you're running this show?
Sure. It's Allegory and Ideology, Fredric Jameson. It's a 2019 book. It's the second volume of his series called Poetics of Social Forms. When I say second volume, that doesn't mean that it's sequentially second.
Mm-hmm.
It is metaphorically second or allegorically second because
We're fucking just right into the thick of it, aren't
That's right. It's very hard to determine which volumes are actually parts of the Poetics of Social Forms. There is a book that you have to buy that's not a Jameson book. It's called Periodizing Jameson. And there's a guy who wrote the book. And the whole premise, I think, is that he like bugged Jameson until Jameson told him, hey, here is the ordering.
Is this like a Fast and the Furious thing where it's like they're metaphorically in order, but they temporally happen at different times, so you have to figure this out and have a separate book just to describe what actual order you should read them in?
That's right. It's exactly like that. It's exactly like the Fast and the Furious
Hell
sequels.
Yeah, nailed it.
You know what they say where we're from? Show me how you drive, I'll show you who you are.
And this is the best one. This is volume 2.
So hold on. So what was the first volume then?
It hasn't been published yet. that's what I mean by not sequential, is that the last volume has been published, and the last, all except one have been published at this point. The last volume is Archaeologies of the Future.
Oh, yeah, which we've talked about on the show before, actually.
So that's volume 6. And the rest of the numbering is nonsensical. I don't really buy it. But this is volume 2. And the volume 1 is going to be his work on narrative.
Oh, it's like a Christopher Nolan thing, right? Where he publishes them backwards?
Not really backwards, though. Like, it's like jumping around.
It's and jumping like, all over the place?
One volume is like two volumes. One volume is two books. It's a little bit it's a little bit pretentious. But, you know, this is volume 2.
That feels like the most perfect way to start off an episode about Jameson. Is just like, this is horribly confusing, kind of pretentious, but also, you know, fascinating in certain ways. So this is published by Verso, right?
Yeah.
And I know you were mentioning that typically Jameson's other works are published by like Cornell and Duke and Princeton. And so I think you had some thoughts on something about why, like, why should we do this book of all the Jameson books? And you kind of had mentioned that this one really hadn't been reviewed as much because it isn't published by a more academic press. Is that right?
I think so. I'm not sure if like the majority of his books are published by an academic imprint, but the big ones, the ones that everyone reads, the big interventions of Jameson are The Political Unconscious and Postmodernism, and those are both published by some other non-internal to the left publisher, not Haymarket, not Verso, not even like Minnesota or something. It's published by Princeton and Cornell, I believe. So it requires people to review it. It requires people to read it if it's published by an academic publisher.
Yeah.
So there's a kind of a cottage industry of people still deciphering those works. This one was a Verso book, so I don't think there is a much of a response to it. And in fact, I think there is like a handful of printed reviews that you can find. And there's a smattering of blogs. But this will definitely be the first podcast on the book. And this might be one of the two or three podcasts on Jameson.
That's true. I was thinking about that. I don't think I've ever really tackled or heard a podcast that focuses on Jameson specifically. So I was super pumped that you decided to do this, because I feel like, it's going to be fairly unique out there in the leftist podcasting landscape. And also, just so you know, I feel like you had to be the person to do Jameson specifically. Of all the people I know, of all the people, you know, who read theory and are into politics, I feel like you have the best chance of making Jameson graspable and understandable. So just so you know, like, you have a kind of a high place in my mind of being able to do something like this.
That's very good. Well, first, one of the podcasts that actually is on Jameson is by like QAnon people. It's like by like a, it's a really like red-pilled YouTuber doing a podcast on Jameson.
Hold on, but is it like postmodern neo-Marxist shit?
Yeah, it is.
Oh, damn.
It's like Jameson and Derrida or something, but I didn't listen to it, but it looked really cool.
Hold on, are you saying that's not what we're doing here? We're not going to try to red-pill everyone?
We are going to be really based and really red-pilled is what we are going to be. No, another thing is that like I'm completely unqualified to talk about this. I'm not studying to be like faculty in a comparative literature department or English department or any of those, like, or even like philosophy. So whatever I say here will be like very provisional and almost entirely internal to Jameson, because a lot of the references that he makes, and whenever he talks about like Grimas or about pretty much like any reference about Sartre, I've never read much of Sartre. I think I've read like bits of Being and Nothingness, and I've read bits and pieces of like his fiction.
Yeah.
But I never read like the big philosophical kind of
corpus. Critique of Dialectical Reason, stuff like that.
Yeah, but to read Critique of, I feel like to read Critique of Dialectical Reason, you have to read the core of Sartrean philosophy.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Which is very much in continuity with it.
Sure.
And I've never been able to, and that's kind of like very limiting in terms of interpreting Jameson in context.
Mm.
So it should be taken pretty, even though I appreciate your kind of having me as this high stage, I don't think I kind of live up to that.
Well, it's all right. So that means, you know, your fall will just be quite glorious, and it's going to happen on the show. So
that's right. Yeah,
no, I will say too, I think that one of the reasons why whenever we do episodes and who sort of comes on to do books, I actually really appreciate that it's not necessarily people who are already academics or doing PhD programs. I mean, I think the idea is to say it's open to for anyone to be able to read these books, and, you know, they're very difficult, and we're going to try to do our best to make them, you know, graspable and understandable and relevant, I think, precisely because we're not necessarily academics. We're just people who are interested in this stuff, think it's important, and care about it and want to read it and try to share it with others. So, well, do you want to give some background on Jameson? Because I know we've talked about him, we mentioned him on the show before, but I don't know, since we're doing an episode just on Jameson, it might be helpful to just to give listeners an idea of who the fuck is this guy? Why are we talking about him? What's his relevance, contributions, things like that?
Sure. Rather than talk about kind of biographical detail of Jameson, I think what we should start with is kind of this premise of, on the one hand, Marxist literary criticism, and on the other, kind of theory. And this is something I don't think is really kind of discussed, because it's kind of like knowledge that you acquire after a certain like leveling up. Is that you just, the way the journey of theory begins is this kind of almost mythological narrative of like, yeah, it's almost primal. It doesn't matter what actually happens to you. This happens to you regardless, is that you walk to the store, the bookstore, and you pick up a book. The author of the book is inevitably Slavoj Žižek, and you buy it, and you feel
fucking
really
called out right now.
You feel really great. You feel fantastic. You're the smartest person on earth, and then you walk home, and you can't quite read it. It's referencing all these things. It's, it has like footnotes in German, and
you know, I just have to say really quick, now that you mentioned this, I think my introduction to Jameson was through reading fucking Žižek. So there you go.
Well, I think everyone.
Yeah, that's probably
I think
true.
This is why this is a true narrative, is that it happens to literally every single person.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think that on that journey, something happens. Like there's something like, I don't want to sound pretentious, but like something like a desire to understand and to learn about the world, and theory kind of answers it in a very specific way. And Marxist literary criticism also answers that specific demand in a very specific way. Mm-hmm. It doesn't answer it in a kind of a straightforward way. What we would like to do is to know the world and why things happen and how to change it. But to do so, we have these books about essentially like interpretation of 19th century French literature. Mm-hmm. And it's not obvious why those two, like kind of the question and the answer, correspond.
Yeah.
And I think to understand that, you have to kind of think about the history of Marxist literary criticism as a kind of a vocation or as a concept. One thing is that it's a little bit like the Holy Roman Empire. It's like the joke about the Holy Roman Empire is that it's not holy, it's not Roman, it's not an empire. And Marxist literary criticism is not really all that concerned with Marx. And Jameson, I think, as the kind of time went by, wasn't really all that concerned with particular adherence to Marxist formulae or like economical analysis, all that. I think his whole project is kind of against that, is that we don't really need, or perhaps we need it, but in a kind of a attenuated way. Mm. So it's not really Marxism, and it's not really criticism. It's not really about like passing literary or aesthetic evaluative judgment. And it's not really about literature, because from the very beginning, it concerned other kind of media, TV, film, photography, and architecture.
Can I ask you really quick, Comrade Marv? So is the whole point of calling it Marxist literary criticism almost because it doesn't really fit anywhere else? I mean, so what's the sort of logic of describing it as such if it doesn't really fit into that category?
I think there's a dual kind of logic to it. One logic is the real world, like almost like institutional materialism of philosophy departments in Anglo-American academia didn't really accept this type of thinking. And sociology departments were kind of dominated by a different type of thought. So they all concentrated in essentially English and aesthetic literary criticism departments.
Almost like being pushed into there because of the material conditions of the institutions?
Yeah.
Okay.
There's also like a story of the expansion of the American institutions. Mm-hmm. So like this is like a thing that Barry Anderson talks about in respect to someone like Raymond Williams and his generation, is that a lot of people found jobs and were attracted to posts in America because America had a lot of like openings, but they didn't have openings or necessarily was welcoming in the philosophy departments. So people kind of moved into like sociology in this expanded sense. So you would have to like find other openings. That's one answer. The other answer, which I think is the one that Jameson would take, is that interpretation of the world, understanding of the world, and understanding of literature are in some sense kin. There is some sort of relation or allegory between them. Whenever you are kind of trying to understand the conditions of why a certain historical event happens, you are inevitably called back to thinking about character and narrative and causality in literature. Evaluations of political kind like character judgments are usually just projections of those or extensions of judgments of character in literature. And like a lot of the 19th century great literature of Russian, French, English literature was always these deep studies of character, of what makes a person a certain way, makes him act a certain way. Those judgments, both in terms of literary kind of judgment and in terms of actual political judgment, are kin. They're similar. And in fact, one could say more. One could actually say that the literary judgment is first, because you're exposed to these complex characters both internally and externally first through literature. You never get the kind of viewing of personality or temporality that you get in the book. You don't get that in real life. You don't get these kind of thoughts. You don't get someone explaining to you exactly how temporality works through memory or forgetting, or you don't get that kind of experience in real life except by kind of comparing it to the literary experience.
So for Jameson, is the idea that the literary encounter is sort of what sets up our kind of general model of how we're going to use that type of judgment for real world events and sort of understanding history in a certain way?
I think there's definitely a coextensive realm of interpretation. Like, you know, you have interpretive judgment of the literary work and interpretive judgment of historical fact or historical work. And those two domains are not rigidly separate. They're definitely like coextensive. So that's one explanation. The other explanation is to kind of recede back, which is also the one that Jameson also employs, is that you, not only are these like coextensive domains, but also the operation of the mind that's required in understanding is the same. So like, it's not only that one can aid you, which is, you know, anyone can tell you that reading a book can kind of help you understand the world, but it's more that the very process of reading and writing and reflection is the same, is fundamentally the same, and it has the same kind of problems, has the same blockages. So the aporias of literary criticism, the problems of representability, the problems of actual characterization, the problems of realism, those are also the problems in political imagination. So this is the great like kind of move of Jameson in science fiction, is that thinking about utopia is actually political thinking. You're not just thinking about the kind of a fictional, you know, world where, you know, Martians rule or whatever. You're also thinking about the possibilities of human kind of arrangements, social arrangements, and every work is a kind of a laboratory of the future. So any kind of detectable symptomatic blockages in either of those departments, in either political thinking or also in kind of in a kind of imaginative thinking, they're related, they're coextensive, and they are in some sense the same. They are like allegorically kind of tied together.
So would the idea be that through trying to understand and identify and maybe even interpret what those blockages are in sort of the literary domain or in this imaginative kind of writing, it can give us insight into what those same blockages might be in the political realm?
That's right. And I think it's more than that. It's that developing kind of capacities. It's not just the kind of descriptive claim. It's also prescriptive claim. You can actually develop your capacities for imagination in one domain, and it will also lead to a thinking, a utopian thinking in the political domain. And nourishing those kind of capacities is very much remains and was from the beginning the project of Jameson. I wanted to touch on briefly on the fact that Marxism, which is the preferred hermeneutic of Jameson, is the Marxist dialectic. Marxism, unlike a lot of other social theories or sociologies, or philosophies of history, these are kind of related terms in for Jameson, contains within it an aesthetics and a poetics. It contains a kind of an evaluative critical theory of literature and art, and it contains a kind of what for Jameson is the poetics of how to build, how to actually evoke these feelings and experiences, and how to produce texts that are, at least in some sense, valuable and good and interesting. Whereas a lot of social theories don't. It's hard to think of like a Rawlsian aesthetics or a Rawlsian poetics, how to write a novel in a Rawlsian way, or a Habermasian. You know, you could talk about like the transparency of ideal speech situation, but that doesn't really translate into a good novel or a good symphony. In much the same way, I think it's quite difficult to think of someone like Talcott Parsons and to think of him as a aesthetic thinker. Whereas tradition of Western Marxism is nothing if not a tradition of aesthetics, of producing a kind of coherent body of thought of how to interpret cultural and literary texts. So that's kind of an interesting problem. Why is that? Why do some social theories, why do some philosophies of history kind of come inbuilt with a theory of literature and poetics? And for Perry Anderson, the answer lies in the fact that Marxism is critical. Marxism pronounces a judgment on society. It doesn't just kind of evaluate a particular social formation. It also pronounces a kind of a verdict. Is it good or is it bad? Is it progressive or is it reactionary? For me, that's not really true. because quite a lot of social theories are evaluative, even if they're not necessarily kind of, they're not demand a rupture. They do demand a kind of a change, or they do point towards some sort of normative end.
Mm-hmm.
Von Hayek is probably the great social theorist of the conservative right. It's very hard to think of a von Hayekian book, like or a novel or a poem, whereas we have these Marxist kind of books and poems. So the particular act of critical judgment does not define a good or bad social theory that has aesthetics or not. What I think is unique about Marxism, what I think Marxism kind of brings to the table that other social theories do not, is a theory of subjectivity, is that it accounts for individual experience and for the individual experience of everyday life, as well as kind of the flows and ebbs of the like great social formation. It's not just a theory of kind of a social integration or disintegration. It's a theory of kind of the way a life is lived,
mm-hmm.
or a particular type of Marxism does, which is why it's easy to talk about, again, the Western Marxist tradition that has an aesthetics and a tradition of Marxism that perhaps doesn't, of sociology or historiography that focuses purely on kind of, for example, the employment rates or the ratio of rent among like European peasantry or something. The latter might not necessarily have an aesthetics, the former does. And as long as you account for this subjectivity, then you can kind of speak of like the subjective reaction to a text,
mm-hmm.
and how to evoke it. If you actually have a theory as a thing that it has kind of explanation or a symptomatic description of desired phenomenon, like effect in you, then you can have how to evoke it with a literary means. So I think that's what makes Marxism so kind of expressive in the domain of literary study. And that's why Jamesonian, kind of, if he has a Marxism, his Marxism comes from the very unique source of Jean-Paul Sartre, which for whom Marxism was primarily, or the Marxism of his late thought of the Critique of Dialectical Reason, was a Marxism of subjectivity,
mm-hmm.
of being able to describe subjective consciousness without speaking of it as consciousness, without speaking of it in an idealist way, but as a kind of a directional desire for something, like being able to kind of articulate it as a lack of a particular place. Instead, you kind of view the world as a series of situations to which you are kind of committed, and so on. Those kinds of pictures and figurations are central to Jameson's Marxism. And that's what kind of creates this critical position, is that you are able to see experience, subjectivity, as a kind of object of study. And therefore, then you can kind of, at the same time, in the same register, talk of the study of society and the study of literature.
So let's say someone's listening to this and, again, being exposed to Jameson for the first time. And I know we're kind of covering a very broad range of Jameson's project that runs through, you know, decades and many, many books. If you had to say, for someone being newly exposed to this, like, why read Jameson, or what's valuable and what's important in his project in the way that you just described? Like, what would you say for someone newly exposed to him?
I think what I actually like about it, or how I kind of came to it, is mm-hmm. that it's a very expansive project. It's a project of like of real ambition. It's someone who says, oh, to understand the world, you have to read Proust. And this is just like as simple as that. Unless you read Proust, you cannot understand eternity or the absolute.
Yeah.
And you cannot understand why, you know, the world crisis is happening. You mm-hmm. have to read this. And then here's how it kind of all relates together.
Sure.
I think that's a really cool idea, is that like, not just like in a kind of a AP English teacher kind of way of, if you read Huckleberry Finn, you'll understand race relations in America. It's more like, in a very formal way, there is a relationship. There's kind of interrelationships between very disparate phenomena in the world. And I think the task of like the theoretical mind, if there is one, is to find those connections,
mm-hmm.
to see how one thing causes the other. And I think it stands or falls on this ability to evoke these, what now are probably will always be called allegories, between different kind of areas of life, different fields, and their interrelationships, and how they're actually all tied together in a single totality. I think the ability to say that is really powerful to me, is that like, yeah. I'll be able to kind of, it might like satisfy some sort of psychological or psychoanalytical urge to dominate the nature,
mm-hmm.
but it also does, I think, satisfy a kind of a poetic desire to see in the Hegelian way, to see in the flows of being, to see also yourself, to place yourself and to understand why something's happening, how yeah. is it happening, and exactly what is the upshot, why must we read at all, why mm-hmm. must we read, why must we think. So in that way, I think it's very good. Alongside with that, I think there's a kind of a boyish charm to Jameson. I think I always think of him, he's not an old man, I was just back from reading Adorno, And
I was just reading Adorno yesterday.
And it's just like an old man who's just upset at everything, and it just has this sort of negative prescriptions for everything. We must not read this. We must not think this. We must not apply this. Jameson is not like that. Jameson is immediate, kind of quick comparison. This, like, these little parentheticals that invade his prose. In this book, it's almost ridiculous. Like, in the first chapter, there's like every sentence is followed by a parenthetical remark about something else. And you feel this giddiness to him. You feel like kind of a desire to kind of interject and say things like, oh yeah, there would be like a big kind of overwrought sentence about like, oh yeah, here's how the flows of time, whatever, what I just said 5 seconds ago. And then there'll be like a little remark. And here's why like the French wig makers were all counter-revolutionaries. Because if you don't have wigs, you don't have their business would be destroyed. And the revolution very directly destroyed their material kind of conditions. And this is why like there's all these like diaries of wig makers being like, oh no, we must uphold the rule of Louis, of the king. Long live the king. Which is, I think, a very funny thing. But it's also, I think, a very real kind of kind of cool insight. And it's kind of full of these like little gems of like, on every page, I think he says in one of his interviews is that on every page there has to be something to kind of feast on. There has to be like a little tidbit for you. And, you know, again, like you have to kind of go back almost to the phenomenology of reading, is that like every time you read a page, you learn something interesting and cool and a way of saying something that's really strange and not anything that you'll ever hear before or heard before, or again, you'll never hear it again. So that's what I like about it, is that it has like the grand proposition, which is that, you know, there's a project of poetics of social life, is that you can kind of figure out how the basic constituent parts of your intelligence or your intellect are putting together the reality, are putting together the fabric of the layered kind of cake of life. But also you get like these like little pleasures of reading of someone with a very kind of almost ridiculous intellect, kind of someone who's read every book.
Yeah, it's unbelievable reading anything by him. Yeah. Just sort of be completely just overwhelmed and engulfed in like his mind and his base of knowledge. It's terrifying sometimes.
Yeah, but also I think it's very cool. It's like it's someone who retains a kind of a combative, like at 86 or 7 years old, he retains a kind of a very combative and a very cheeky kind of familiarity with his works. He's not, there's no respect. People don't get respect in Jameson. You get like a little...
Rodney Dangerfield of
that's
theory.
Right. Yeah.
No respect. I don't get no respect.
People get like taken, you know, to the cleaners over very interesting things. And it's funny and good, I think. There's, in this book, I don't really remember much, but in Valences of the Dialectic, there's like a little cheeky footnote about how you know, Martin Heidegger is the real philosopher of the revolution. I'll develop this later. End sentence. Which is cool. I don't know. It's a footnote 25, I think, in the last essay of Valences of the Dialectic. Mm-hmm. And you're just like, oh yeah, you know, just wait, coming soon. There'll be a whole exposition about how Martin Heidegger was the real revolutionary philosopher. I don't know. That's cool. That tickles me. I like that. I like, again, like he's not Adorno and he's not Sartre. He's not any of these people. He has a kind of a vitality to him. He's alive. And this prose is like, after reading it, there's a kind of a dimension of it that brings it to real kind of, to me, like a kind of vitality of like, I want to read more. I want to find out more. And that's what I would say to like a freshman. Like, just read Jameson. Just read a book. And don't begin with the postmodernism. And in fact, if you can, just skip that whole period of Jameson. I think we're back in the good area of Jameson. I hope he lives very long. But that argument, I think, of postmodernism, we kind of passed a little bit. And we're kind of passing into a very different problematic that is better, or at least, kind of more fruitful, I think, and less polemical and more open to kind of critical engagement with other positions. Mm-hmm. So I would recommend actually reading a book of interviews with him, Conversations on Cultural Marxism. Mm-hmm. I think it has the name of like Jameson on Jameson or something.
Oh, yeah. I'm familiar with that one, yeah.
Which is, I don't know. But like it has the subtitles, Conversations on Cultural Marxism. And the interesting thing is that you can actually get like a feeling of his ideas of like outside of this prose, which I think should be commented on very separately. But like he kind of would be like making these judgments of, hey, here's what Adorno actually meant. And here's how it works with my philosophy.
So maybe before we dive into notes in the content specifically, I was wondering, you know, you mentioned allegory a couple of times and the relevance of allegory for Jameson. So since this book is also titled Allegory and Ideology, could you speak to how ideology is going to play into some of what you've discussed already, or how the book is structured, or what it's going to cover?
Sure. I would like to kind of pose two figures before we kind of begin discussion of the book. And the two figures are Paul Ricoeur and Louis Althusser. And I think the project of the book is kin to what Ricoeur attempted in the last decade of his life, which was the related projects of books that were published as Time and Narrative and The Rule of Metaphor. And these were like a series of talks that he gave first and then edited together. And the books are, they make a very kind of strong proposition of something like metaphor and the narrative function as these building blocks of life, mm-hmm. of the phenomenon of, you know, like whenever you experience something, you can make connections between different separate strands of experience using metaphor. And this is kind of an Aristotelian thing of like, of the rhetoric, is that someone who sees a metaphor, who recognizes metaphors that, you know, that love is like a rose or whatever, is seeing similarities, is great at seeing those things. And that's part one of kind of the Ricoeurian system. And the second part is that narrative, both literary and historical narrative, and just everyday narrative, forms the experience of time. It produces the experience of time in this kind of anthropological sense, is that, you know, whenever I feel like there's duration, right, of time, I feel it as a story where I'm a character. And whenever I feel like, you know, that history appears to me, I feel it as a narrative, as a story of historical figures. And for Ricoeur, this is basically the constituent parts of life, is that you put together like these stories and narratives using metaphors and narrative, like narrative pieces, and that's experience. And Jameson undertakes, in Valences of the Dialectic, he undertakes a critique of Ricoeur. He doesn't really engage with metaphor as much. He just kind of dismisses it. But he disputes the idea that history and time both kind of appear as narratives, that history is actually more complex. Time does appear kind of in the narrative term, and he's ready to acknowledge that. But history is a more complex beast, and he has a kind of a more attenuated sort of idea of exactly how to make history appear. But the project is kin, is that he's very interested in these kind of constituent blocks of experience. And one of these blocks that is appropriate today is allegory, as opposed mm-hmm. to metaphor. And he has this whole discussion of what allegory means. Allegory for Jameson is this weaving together of two disparate stories or narratives or pieces. And you weave them together, not on the basis of similarity as metaphor, but on the basis of their difference. And his basic kind of starting point is the classical allegory, the Christian allegory for the Old Testament, is that every story in the Old Testament, or every major story in the Old Testament, can be seen as prefiguring the Gospels. And there will be this four-tiered structure of the literal text of the Old Testament, which would be like the story of Moses, and then it will be the allegorical text of the story of Christ on top of it, overlaid, the differences and similarities kind of compared. You could see one in the other without necessarily subsuming the story of the Old Testament in the New Testament. And then above it were these two additional levels of the moral and the anagogical. The moral would be the story of the individual soul, perhaps of the reader, of someone who is interpreting the story of how to live an ethical and a good life in union with Christ, obviously. Mm-hmm. So it's building on the second level. And the final story would be the story of the Holy Spirit, of how the community of believers can achieve a unity and ultimately a kind of a heaven on earth or a kingdom of heaven somewhere. And this was like the allegory, the four-tier structure was the tool for interpreting the Old Testament. Jameson adapts this for his purposes, but he retains the structure. He views the first level as the text or the first initial kind of starting material, the raw material. The second level is the allegorical interpretation. So something that we want to compare to these two things. We want to be able to weave together two different strands. And on the third level would be the moral, which for Jameson is a kind of a way to talk about the psychoanalytical or the existential. And the fourth level is the political. So this is the kind of, the structure is retained, but the levels are first are complicated, and second, they're kind of set in motion. That's one of the operations that Jameson provides, is that once you have these two levels, the first or two texts or two interpretations, you can kind of shuffle them together. You can see what exactly comes out. You can interchange them. You can begin with an allegorical text and then see how what was seen initially as the literal text was actually prefigured in the allegorical text. And you can also see how a lot of like liberal interpretations or a lot of kind of very more down-to-earth interpretations end in the moral. They don't really extend to the anagogical level in the collective being. And also the collective being is kind of always occluded to us generally because we can't really understand it except allegorically. Mm-hmm. We can't really begin with a story or represent the story of everyone. Of Jameson likes quoting the Sloterdijk quote of, you can't really think of yourself alongside, you know, 9 billion other people, 9 billion other subjects. It's very hard to think of that. Like, how can there'd be 9 billion voices. How can you actually produce a single narrative, a story for them? You can only do that with the tools of allegory. You can only see it as either personification, is that there are peoples, nationalities, or you can see it as classes, which are in turn also personifications, is that there is a proletarian character or will, and that in turn has its own kind of story and so on. So that's a kind of the basic structure of allegory. Jameson applies it to different texts in this collection. But this is the hot tip for reading Jameson, is that you don't read the full book, or you do read it, you know, as you have time. But Jameson doesn't write a book. He writes the first chapter, and you read the first chapter very carefully, because the first chapter is the one that's actually kind of has the argument.
Yeah.
And then you read the rest kind of, because, you know, there's in this book, there is very good, I think, chapter on Dante, very good chapter on Mahler, interesting chapter on Hamlet. And then there's a chapter on Spencer, and on, there's an appendix on Dennett, on Daniel Dennett and Consciousness Explained. That's kind of good. That's pretty good. But the main part of the argument is delivered in the first two chapters, or in the preface and the first chapter. And then there's a conclusion at the end. But that's the kind of the machinery of that Jameson brings. This is kind of simple in terms of you can kind of lay it out. On top of that, he layers these other kind of thinkers and theories and interpretations, is that he sees himself, and this is in the interviews, he sees himself as a kind of someone who provides, on the one hand, validity to the Marxist project by engaging all of these like complex theories in addition to his own. So he would be, you know, this is his project, begins with Sartre and incorporates people like Northrop Frye, Gramsci, Heidegger, all these other thinkers, Deleuze, into a single kind of project. But without like synthesis, it's very eclectic. He kind of pulls strands together. He can show you how Marxism is still vital and alive, in addition to doing actual theory, which actually you can kind of see as an allegory, is that the first step, if you take the Jameson text, you take the text of Allegory and Ideology, as the interpretive code or the allegorical text, you can take the kind of, there is an exoteric text that's addressed to everyone, to the general public, but there's also kind of an esoteric text, a text of Marxist theory or how Marxist theory should be practiced. When you're in a tradition and you produce a text within the tradition, any tradition, Islamic tradition or the Christian tradition, it is also kind of a manual. You're also usually correcting errors of people that came before you. Mm-hmm. You're projecting a kind of a future for the tradition. Your work is constitutive of the tradition as well as coextensive with it. So for Jameson, the second level, I would say, is Marxism or some sort of like critical theory of literature and also of society. And the third level would be, how does one kind of come to understanding of theory? How does one actually like figure out what exactly is involved in understanding and developing theoretical consciousness, for example? That would be like the existential or psychoanalytic level. Would be, what exactly is involved in understanding of, what exactly is science? What exactly is involved in understanding of causality and so on, and symptomatic readings? And the fourth level would be the level of kind of how theoretically minded praxis is possible for everyone, not just for, we don't just read these books to read them, we read them to kind of act in some way. And how that collective action is possible would be like the allegory of Jameson.
And so coming back to the role of ideology in all of this. So yeah, I mean, where does Jameson see that being a relevant word to include in the title?
Yeah. So ideology for Jameson is a very specific reference, I think, to Althusser. Or the problematic announced by Althusser.
And so you said that Ricoeur and Althusser were sort of the two prefigurative figures for you to think through this book, right?
That's right.
Okay.
He doesn't really respond to them in this book. It's not an Althusserian book and it's not a Ricoeurian book, but it is a project that I think they both kind of announced, the problematic. Sure. Ricoeur, I think, announced a kind of a method for understanding experience, phenomenological approach to both literary studies, a kind of a studies of historical texts, and also experience. So like all of these parts, the things that we talked about before, these coextensive interpretive like moves are actually all can be like subsumed by one schema of interpretation. And Althusser provides a definition of ideology, or the problem of ideology, which is very different. And Jameson kind of modifies his. In Jameson's book, which is a kind of a response to Althusser, is a political unconscious. And he borrows from him this kind of expansive understanding of ideology as not only as a kind of occlusion, as a kind of something that prevents you from seeing the truth, but also as something that constitutes you as a subject, is that you think of yourself, you think of, you know, you are interpolated, you are called as a kind of a worker or a citizen or a particular person, a man. You are called onto that within the network of meanings that's generated by ideology. You are constituted by these networks, and that's what creates you as a subject, or that's what kind of posits you as a subject. Mm-hmm. And that's very productive for Jameson, because he thinks of every theory of reading, in fact, every text, but definitely every philosophy of reading or hermeneutic, posits its own ideology. And it does so by, first, a hermeneutic generally posits that there is a hidden text. There's a second allegorical or whichever text hidden beneath the kind of obvious literal text. And that kind of creates a question of why is there the second text? Why isn't the second text the first text? Why isn't it obvious? Why don't people get the main meaning, this hidden meaning?
Yeah.
There must be some sort of occlusion. There must be a kind of a, without anthropomorphizing it, there is a kind of a deceiver somewhere that's making it difficult to understand. Why didn't Christ just come, you know, at the time of the Old Testament? Why was he necessary? Why didn't we just write books that kind of explain the world as opposed to having this bizarre system of interpretation? Why didn't Shakespeare just write a book of historical materialism? I mean, why didn't he? The reason why is because this level of consciousness is not available to you, or it's prevented from you, or it wouldn't be even like if you were to write it down, or if it were possible for you to write it down, you would not be able to cognize it. You would not be able to understand it. And that is a theory of ideology, is that there is a kind of a blockage. There is an inability to think beyond a kind of societal bracketing. There is a kind of a things like inability to really express consciousness or ethical belief in writing, except as kind of dicta or kind of as these big pronouncements of, you know, what is really important. You know, there's a kind of the totality isn't really like, you can't write it. You can think it together collectively, but you cannot, or act it. You can act the totality, but you cannot write it down. Mm-hmm. And you cannot kind of film it or, you know, picture it. And that's the big problem. But in that problem, through that problem, you also see these other things. You can treat that as this great tragedy of life, of like, oh, we're not able to kind of communicate fully and effectively, and we're not able to be happy together. Or you could treat it as a kind of a call to action. Every work is a failure in this understanding, is that every work fails to communicate this kind of expressive totality that we all desire. Every work of literature is. But it kind of points towards it. It promises us the totality. Every work contains this promise of happiness. And our job is to kind of determine it, to understand it, and to kind of decode it. So, you know, you could interpret it in both ways. You can see it as a great, like, Kantian divide between, or more than Kantian, it's actually, like, more fundamental divide between, like, action and cognition. Is that, like, we can't quite connect the arm to the brain and actually, you know, do the thing that we need to do. But you could also treat it as a kind of a progressive kind of construction of the second solution, of being able to kind of collectively interpret and access the absolute, or, you know, tap the absolute slightly by these successive moves. And it definitely, I think, rings true, is that, like, we might not quite get to the absolute, but there is something eternal and real in poetry and in art and in science also. There's something like a truth there, even if it's not all the truth all the time. But there is something like an urge that it satisfies.
So for someone who maybe is familiar with the idea of false consciousness and that idea of ideology, so how would you relate what this sort of approach and what Jameson's sort of project is and how you're describing it to the idea of false consciousness?
So there are multiple ideas, I think, there. Jameson's work isn't really like a position on a systematic kind of philosophy or social theory. So he kind of plays around with these ideas. He plays around with both kind of an active false consciousness and a passive ideological kind of prevention or occlusion or interpolation. There are two distinct sets, essentially, of thinking. One is generally from the lineage of the German ideology by Marx and Engels, is that you are actively prevented from knowing about these facts of life, of like the value theory and about how you are being exploited and how the wars that you're fighting are imperial wars and all that. That's just propaganda. They're literally just concealing these facts from you. All you need to do is to just pick up the right book and figure out what's there and act. All you need to do is kind of organize, is to organize kind of right now, is that you just pick up a book, figure out what's going on, and then go talk to people. There's another idea, which is where Althusser, I think, comes in, which is that the one I try to describe, which is that there's a pervasive kind of determination of meaning in life, is that you're a worker, not just because you were told that, oh, get $10 an hour for doing this. You're also a worker because you think of yourself as a worker. There is a kind of a understanding that, oh yeah, my father had a wage job and, you know, I could also contract, I guess. That's also another thing I could do, but I would be paid for an hour of work and that's okay. I know that my boss always like tries to limit my time, you know, tries to kind of play and, you know, fuck with my hours, but that's, you know, that's okay. That's just what happens.
Yeah.
That's just life. And in that kind of expression of that's just life, I think there lies the whole mountain of the programming that goes into it, is that like, well, why is it life? Why is that like a given thing? Why is that something that you just accept? you know, and one could like just see that as just kind of being wrong or misled, but it does ring true. Like, I think in our society, it does ring true that, you know, you got to work. I'm sorry, but, you know, like, you might complain, but you got to work. You can't just like sit around and do nothing all day. You know, people are starving on the street. Why are you? And so on. Like, that just comes out very naturally. Like, that's just like a very natural thing to say. And you kind of go like, yeah, I guess, you know, that's not, I could use my money to do something else. I could kind of figure out a way. I can't just be a nothing. Like, I'm not like a homeless person. You know, I'm not one of these people. And so on. Like, these lines come very naturally to us. They're not just, you know, they're not just like a false or true statement. They are just kind of, they are true in our consciousness. We do believe that. Mm-hmm. I do believe that in some way that, you know, if you can work, you should work, you know, like, that's just a thing. But, and to like undo that, I don't know what else will come into its place. You'd have to think very creatively. What could a society without work be? How is that different from like just laying around? Like, we would just be bored all the time, you know, all that kind of thing. So
I feel like that was shots fired at some post-worker thought.
That's right, yeah. I mean, I'm not a huge fan of the thought, but
I know you're not. That's had to flesh that out a little bit.
But like, I don't actually believe that. What I said is actually like very crude. Of like, I don't actually believe that's the problem with it. I think the problem with it is different. But I think they actually pose a very right question. Is that like, well, why is this like a set thing in your mind? Like, why is that just like ineradicable thing? And I think the answer is ideology. Is that we're all kind of immersed in the ideology, and we're all complicit in it.
It's pure ideology,
and it's a very like, it's a very simple thing. It's not a hard thing to understand. It's not like, it doesn't require to read a book because it's so like there. It's, but to actually undo it, you probably have to kind of think much more carefully. The idea, I think, kind of became a property of Slavoj Žižek, in that because he kind of is the popularizer of this kind of, we're all eating out of the trash can, whatever. But, you know, the authorship is Althusser, and like Žižek and Jameson are kind of in relation to Althusser, of definitely disciples of his, in terms of integrating a kind of a psychoanalytical or a structural view of ideology into their thought. Žižek, I think, is much more, this is an idea that's extremely like the center of his idea, of his like thinking. And this is also like, the problematic is at the center of Jameson's thinking. This is actually, I think, every like philosophical or kind of deeply thought response to Marxist problematics is in some sense a response to Althusser. Is that like Althusser actually like philosophized a lot of these ideas and in kind of integrated a lot of theory that was like floating around, that was available. And he is a kind of a, for me, a transitional thinker. He himself isn't like a very deep person with whom like it's possible to engage very deeply, because he wrote very fragmentary things.
Yeah.
He wrote at best like two books, like, but those are books on the Machiavelli and the other one on Spinoza.
Yeah. Spinoza book, right?
Yeah. But he wrote mainly like little programmatic little pieces on like, hey, you know, here's an interesting way of like figuring the dialectic, or understanding what exactly is wrong with humanism, or exactly what's wrong with the subject position. So Jameson is, I think, an enemy of Althusser in the sense of, he definitely is a kind of proponent of what Althusser was struggling against, the existential kind of Marxism, and of kind of the primacy of narrative and a primacy of interpretation and of literature, of representative literature and so on. But the problematic inherited by him is he kind of twists this problem. He kind of makes it more like, it's not that the problem is the narrative or the expressive totalities. It's the problem of our inability to think these totalities. Mm. So it kind of like takes Althusser's position and makes it into like a fruitful kind of problem. It's not just that Althusser kind of denounces these things. It's that he is naming the right question. He's saying the right thing that's wrong with society or with Marxist theory. But to kind of respond to it, you have to see it as a moment of Marxist theory. It's like a moment in tradition. Is that he's not just like saying Althusser is wrong, is that Althusser named a productive and interesting opening in theory, and here's how we respond. And his project is this long response to, I think, to Althusserianism. So this is what the ideology, I think, in the title is.
Oh, interesting,
yeah. Yeah, it's this like fusion of these ideas out of like little pieces, bits and pieces of thinking. You put together a subject position, which is necessary for reading and for writing. And within the actual objects, you can kind of symptomatically, which is an Althusserian term, you can symptomatically read ideological kind of problems. You can actually like determine from texts, you can actually determine what the particular historical, political, economical problematic was. And what's interesting, I think, is that while I think a lot of Marxist literary criticism is not Marxist, it's not really literary, it's not really criticism. The one book of Althusser, that's the big book, Reading Capital, is a book of Marxist literary criticism. It's a book about Reading Capital, a book of Marx. It's a book about applying literary criticism techniques to the work of Marx, and it's a book of criticism. It's a book of like determining what exactly is good about it, what exactly is new about it. So that's the one book, I think, the only book of Marxist literary criticism is a book by Althusser. and Balibar and the rest of them. So yeah, that's what I kind of see the problem posed by the book, by Allegory and Ideology, is that we have this world, a phenomenological world. Jameson adds a kind of historical point to this, is that the reason why we need the process of reading things allegorically, allegoresis, the reason why we need allegoresis is because today, especially, we have a lot of trouble actually producing works that could be read like literally and produce kind of meaning in a very obvious way. We have these problems of producing these kind of accesses to totality. Instead, we must think of things allegorically. This is a problem of representability. We can't represent these things that we talked about earlier. We can't actually like write a book of political revolution because we can't think these totalities of the many, of the multitude. Instead, we must write these works of allegorical works that are like expressing the totality in these ways of character. You have to kind of personify it. And then you must apply this system of, if you want to read something collectively, you must apply this four-tiered system where like at the first step, it's just what the text says. And that last step, we can kind of actually access the meaning that we want to access. And with the multiplication of meaning and the thing that Jameson, I think, used to call postmodernism, and now it's mostly called, he kind of walked that back slightly, is that he talks about late modernity or postmodernity. There's a multiplication of meanings, of subject positions. There's a kind of a general denunciation of writing this stuff in a direct way, writing about the absolute. And instead, you kind of have these fragmentary narratives, fragmentary subject positions, which you must, again, like to actually produce a coherent body, to kind of tap into the totality, you must kind of weave them together. You must take one fragmentary or very like microscopic or macroscopic narrative, like a book of like Infinite Jest, or compared with it, like a work of someone like Nausgaard. You must take them and then see in them, apply to them like a kind of an interpretive schema, because by themselves, they don't even try to express a kind of totality and eventually arrive at this kind of collective meaning.
I'm really glad you mentioned that, because my next question I was going to ask you is that for Jameson, and maybe for you, you know, reading Jameson, what are some examples of texts, of works that in some way you could see do this or somehow fit into this in a way that you could apply that four-tier schema to and have that last level of sort of, yeah, the collective, almost like totality in the absolute that it does sort of indicate.
Yeah, so for Jameson, it's every text.
Literally, yeah, it's everything. All of them, right?
Yeah, every text has within it, but some texts are more amenable to it. So the text is kind of divided into two. One is like texts that are not the kind of the practice parts of the book are divided into two. One is works that are kind of traditionally thought of as allegorical, like Edmund Spenser's Fairy Queen, or Faustus, or what's the other one? Dante, the Divine Comedy. Those are already thought of as allegorical in a very obvious way. Whereas works like Hamlet generally isn't thought of as allegorical, and Daniel Dennett isn't generally thought of as allegorical. But I think Consciousness Explained is actually an interesting one, because it taps into something that I always kind of wondered about, which is that we have these really great problems of understanding consciousness. Like really, like in the analytical tradition, this is like, you don't really talk about this because it's so difficult. And so not even that difficult. You don't know where to begin. How do you begin about even like, you can't even start. Instead, you have to like latch onto essentially a sort of neuropsychology, is that neuropsychology provides the answer because they kind of know how the brain, if you cut up the brain, you know, certain things happen and so on. I think that's what neuroscience is. You cut up the brain. Anyway.
That's totally what they're doing.
That's right. That's all they do. Just sit there and cut up brains. They're like in a French restaurant, just cutting and then send it off.
It's a small plate restaurant.
That's right. Just sheep brains just constantly. But like, like exactly what happens, like when consciousness happens, and Consciousness Explained, apparently I haven't read it. I'm not touching that.
But I've had it on my shelf for years, and I fucking avoid it like the plague. Yeah, I think I got it for $1 at the same bookstore that we met at.
I think there's like a bunch of copies of Daniel Dennett books that have been there since, you know, time immemorial.
Yeah,
just collect dust. That's the real Consciousness Explained. But like yeah, you know, Jameson books just fly off the shelf, and this guy is just like there. It's just him and Dawkins are there.
Just holding down the fort.
That's right.
The stalwarts.
That's right. Consciousness Explained doesn't explain consciousness. That's the big kind of joke, is that it doesn't actually, it's not a work of explanation. It's a work of kind of refutation. Mm. It refutes a particular idea of consciousness, which is, Dennett calls it the Cartesian theater, is that our idea of consciousness is that we are spectators in a kind of a play of phenomena. Not really from Descartes, but it's akin to it. There is a kind of an idea of that we are kind of, the phenomenon is a kind of like a a flowing of events, mm-hmm. and we're just, there's an intellect or intellection that sits behind and kind of figures out the different particular things. And this is a problematic, an existential problematic, actually, is that, like, well, actually, you know, it's not actually a flow in front of you. You are the flow. You kind of are constituting the flow. And Dennett is actually not that hostile to Jameson. What's hostile to him is that the explanations are usually evolutionary. Is that, like, oh yeah, yeah. Well, the pineal gland or whatever, the stuff evolved as in this particular way with cortex. It's the cortex involved in a particular way.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why this is the case. But the reason why Dennett undertakes this, when the big punchline comes, in a way, it's also like a critique of the political, is that the work kind of denounces dictatorial kind of thinking or totalitarianism, because the idea of there being an intellect in the center sitting and receiving the things and then making decisions is actually a kind of a democratic critique of, no, that's not how things work. That's not how things work in life, and that's not how things work in your head.
Mm-hmm.
Is that you're not actually a dictator of you know, the sense machine. You are the sense machine, and the sense machine is multiple. There's like multiple areas of the brain that work to create this illusion of consciousness, or the feeling experience of consciousness, and that whenever something happens, there's like a crisis situation, and everyone kind of has to, there's a kind of a, Dennett calls it like the virtual kind of leader emerges of like, okay, this is the thing that we care about, and this is what we're doing, which is actually is a dictatorship, but a dictatorship of the Roman model, you know, like an emergency leadership.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But his kind of critique actually is a critique of kind of in a democratic vein of like exactly what's going on with kind of cognition. And that's the allegory, is that like there's a kind of a political reading of this,
mm-hmm.
a political, not just like it's an interpretation of the text, but this is like there's a political kind of story or narrative that's weaved into the literal story of the brain.
And of evolutionary biology. And
evolutionary biology. It's yeah. evolutionary psychology. It's not just biology. It's yeah, just yeah. like, oh, you know, why do you think? Oh, it's because, you know, language center developed and we kind of hacked the language center, mm-hmm. you know. So like thinking is a hack. It's like instead of just like ordering things of like food or whatever out loud or signaling, we kind of started talking to ourselves, and that's thinking.
So I think based on this, I think Dennett might be a good example of this. Is there a way that a lot of times with more liberal sort of readings of this sort of stuff and this kind of way that we, I think you can draw on like evolutionary biology and psychology and all this other stuff to make these arguments about how the political should be structured or exist? Is that something that Jameson and this way of thinking about text would be very useful for, is to say that, you know, the things that you're drawing on already have this sort of allegorical dimension, this political reading woven in. And whenever you draw on those as just being, this is just what the world is,
mm-hmm.
like this is just how life is that your brain works this way, language works this way. And then maybe we can figure out how to structure the political realm based on that. It's almost like denying that there was the initial allegorical level there in the first place. You just kind of take things as they are, like as they're presented. Does that make sense?
Yeah, kind of. What like a lot of like hermeneutical kind of approaches to life, like psychoanalysis,
uh-huh.
they basically are like this, is that like you present things as they are, right? You say things, oh yeah, I'm just sad because, you know, I got fired or whatever. But then you kind of provide a different narrative of like, well, actually you're sad because you're, you know, you're projecting this thing that happened in your childhood onto life, and you're always dissatisfied with your, and you know, you produce a kind of a counter kind of, or a co-narrative, a narrative of the kind of on the third level or whatever,
mm-hmm.
you up, or this would be the second because you're applying the interpretive code of psychoanalysis to your life. Well, I guess it could be the third because you could say that the first text is your kind of narrative of what happens to you. The second text is your narrative of your childhood development. The third narrative is the psychoanalysis.
Yeah.
So you could always do that. But like I think the position of a lot of these kind of hermeneutic approaches to life and history are that, and Western Marxism is the big tradition in it, is that you are always in a kind of a holding position. You're always in the minority. And there's this proliferation of liberal and reactionary texts, or like texts from a different era when they didn't really understand this politics, collective politics, or didn't really want them. So how do you read them in a kind of in this different way? And I think a lot of these techniques developed as ways of reading that don't necessarily just take the text at the face value. And in fact, the face value of the text is called ideology, is that we don't just like take it. We are given this stuff. And mm-hmm. the work obviously is kind of criticism to kind of announce it and to see it as allegorical or ideological in this way. And then Jameson has like a little passage in here, or like a bunch of indications of this call for action. What are the consequences of this viewpoint, of his viewpoint? And he talks about constructivism. He talks about how the Sartrean idea of like the consciousness and the mind and the subject position is that they are kind of put together. Is that, yes, you are thrown into this life of existence, but you're also like, there is a kind of a a constructive dimension, a dimension of commitment, is that you're not just like thrown by something else. You are the throwing. You are the assemblage of these things together is you. Like it is like the thing that we should be focusing on. And the thing that we should be like doing in a lot of ways is also, instead of confronting these aporias of subject and object, of the dialectical versus a kind of a aporetic thinking, or a thinking of conflict versus a thinking of contradiction. Instead of thinking of these things in those keys, we have to like kind of overcome them. We have to cut the knot. We have to, you know, much the same way that we actually do think, right? Like there is a thought, and much the same way that there is a time, we just assemble it together. In much the same way we would be having this kind of constructive approach to writing, to reading, to thinking, to action, is that we are the acting. We are the actant. We're not just a kind of an interpreter, or we're not just reflecting. We're producing. And that's why I think the book kind of calls for, at some point, terraformism. We have to terraform and morph the earth. We have to like rebuild the earth to deal with climate change. And that's why like he kind of takes the Anthropocene, the climate catastrophe, as a kind of actually an encouraging call, is that we have to kind of transform it, in that we can change the climate, therefore we can change the world. We're not just spectators in life. The Lukacian, and this book is very Lukacian actually, Lukacian call is that we've replaced the whole nature, right? The whatever nature was, if there was ever such a thing. We replaced it wholly with the second nature, the nature that we built, the nature of commodity. The world is now everything, including climate, is under our control in some way. We've conquered life. So now we have to transform it. We have to think productively in a utopian key. We have to actually like take responsibility and do it, commit ourselves to a kind of a freedom and a political imagination that has previously been blocked. We're not just like kind of oppressed by this being unto death. We're not just constantly just lost in this existential in a bad way. Right? We're not just all young Werther kind of just waiting for the great catastrophe. We are active, and we can take responsibility, and we must. So there is both a kind of an interpretive key and also kind of a productive key. Is that you're not just consigned to endless interpretation. You can do stuff.
So at this point, you know, just kind of the time that we find ourselves in, do you feel that a lot of people, you know, maybe a lot of people who identify as being Marxist or on the left in some way, feel that they're trapped in this interpretive key only? I mean, do you feel that that's part of what Jameson offers as a way to understand not only why you're stuck in that interpretive key, but then also like this other realm of action that exists as well that we can identify?
I think there is a mood, always a kind of melancholy. You just finished reading Adorno. So there's always a mood of kind of like, oh, our job, Adorno's great dictum is that like the job of philosophers was to change the world, right? Our job is to interpret, not to interpret the world, but to change it. Mm-hmm. But now revolution failed, so we're back to interpreting it. And Jameson is very much the opposite, is that we have to both interpret and change the world. By through interpreting it, we change the world.
Yeah,
And I think the other thinker is Mark Fisher, who's a very famous, I think, and kind of celebrated thinker on the left. I don't really agree with all these like ideas of, yeah, like hauntings and being kind of lost and endless kind of, you know, the work of philosophy is kind of evaluation of argument. You have to, you know, again, there's a question of commitment. It's not a question of subject and object. It's a question of, we will avoid the dilemmas of that. Like, well, how do you actually act? We'll avoid them by acting in a way. And not in a purely decisionist way, but there is an element of it, is that like, you know, in the action itself, there is a meaning. And in the action of writing and reading, there is a meaning also. We produce it, we create it. We don't have to think too much about exactly what happens. We can think about it, and definitely like we should be thinking about it. This is definitely not precluded. It's not a call for kind of an intellectualist decisionism. But necessity of action, I think, is very obviously signaled. This is also the difference between theory, I think, and philosophy. Is that philosophy, for Jameson at least, is definitely like the kind of unpacking of these metaphysical kind of questions, ontologies, trying to understand like exactly what happens when, you know, when we say a word like meaning. But for him also, you know, there's a kind of a progressive, you know, the more you kind of focus on a particular dilemma, the more you reify it. And reification for Jameson, and this is happens at the end of the book, is that reification for him is not just like a kind of a thing that happens in capitalism. It's almost like one of the very first functions of your mind is that like your intellect first reifies. It's like the first step of the logic is that you begin with this like being and non-being. And the second that you kind of introduce these distinctions and creations and you multiply the beings into one and then into the many, you're already reifying it. You're making it into a thing. You're like, you're taking these things that happen in your head and you're giving them names, or you're giving them kind of distinct entities. You were crossing the ontic ontological divide. And as you do, you are reifying them. You're creating these objects that are not actually there. You're creating like a very faculty of abstract thought for Jameson, stands for reification, which is not bad. Again, this is almost the Adornian move, is that reification is necessary because it provides these opportunities for thought. Reification, these subject-object divides, these like dialectical problems, they're necessary. Even though they do create like kind of aporias and problems and so on, but they also create possibilities. And this is like why the judgment of the postmodern or the late modern age is so ambiguous in Jameson, is that on the one hand, it obviously does kind of, we do lose something of what made modernity so interesting, of what made these modern texts produced by intellectuals in this split position between aristocracy and the bourgeoisie, created these kind of really deep, you know, kind of elaborations of the psyche. So interesting, we might lose some of it. The texts do lose currency. Maybe Lukács is somewhat right in saying that we can only kind of truly access texts that go back like two generations back. If your grandfather wasn't alive when the text was written, he can't really understand what's going on. Mm. That's for him. He was a very radical, vulgar historicism, which is an interesting position. For Jameson, you know, like we do kind of, texts do age, they do lose kind of some of the meaning, and they do kind of accrete this muck on them, which is the reification, is that Aristotle for us is never the Aristotle of the Greeks, Plato for us is never the Plato of the Greeks, and Flaubert for us is never the Flaubert of France. It's of his contemporary kind of environment. Nonetheless, even, you know, like through that, we can kind of cut through. We can kind of create our own meanings. We can kind of create and inspire this other world of meaning through, in particular, allegorical reading. We have to take advantage of the situation that we have. It's not just imposed on us. We can't just like cloister ourselves away, Adorno style of like, okay, you know, there's a great world of music and literature and art, and I'm just the interpreter of that, basically. And I can kind of symptomatically say, well, this is bad or this is bad, this tendency is not good. We have to also kind of productively and actively engage with the current moment in culture and history.
So I'm curious, you mentioned Mark Fisher a second ago, and we both know the popularity of capitalist realism and that it's, you know, easier to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism, which I think initially a Jameson quote. Am I right on that? Do you know, is that...
Someone did an investigation of this. Uh-huh. In Seas of Time, Jameson says something like that. He says, like, some say, usually he like prefaces it by some say today. But again, I think Fisher takes it as a kind of a, I don't disagree with Fisher's work, I don't mean it's a critique, but I think Fisher is taken generally as this proposition, essentially of kind of an Adornian sort of pessimism.
I think so too, yeah.
I'm not sure if that's what he meant. Mm-hmm. It definitely had like much, I mean, I think he was much more in line with Jameson of like, oh yeah, well, we're given this stuff, now we have to do something about it. And I think he wasn't very much on board, he would be very much on board with what's going on with in Britain, the political situation there. And his, I think, thinking wasn't less kind of up in the air as someone like an Adorno would be. Like, but nonetheless, I think it's taken to mean like, oh, you know, we're all in a bad position. We can't really imagine the future.
Well, that's what I was curious what you would say about that, because I think that whenever that phrase gets deployed, I think among people on the left now, it does have that sort of very fatalistic interpretation of, well, there's nothing to be done. Essentially, this is just what we have and it's fucking terrible and that's it. But I think that that's what I find really interesting, is that in this Jameson sort of perspective, it's always that, well, there's also the opportunities here in a really dialectical way. And I think we lose that a lot in the way that Fisher gets talked about and interpreted, you know, among a lot of people on the left right now.
I think like a lot of thinking that we have is there's this opposition between cyclical or, yeah, like kind of a collapse sort of thinking. And this is very prominent in the ecological thought, is that like, well, we are, the planet is burning. You know, Greta Thunberg said, if we don't do something tomorrow, the planet will fucking, you know, disappear. You know, like my whole world, my children will die.
Greta fucking Thunberg, on the cover of Time. Jesus Christ. She's 14. She should be in time out. Fucking climate change. It's always fucking change.
And it could not be further from Jameson's thought. I don't think that climate catastrophe never appears. First of all, he never calls it a catastrophe. He always calls it the Anthropocene. Mm-hmm. Because for him, the idea that humans can change the world, the cosmology of the world, directly change it, means that, you know, that's an opportunity. We can definitely reverse it. If we can change it, we can reverse it or ameliorate it or go to the stars, you know, like that's...
And almost just to clarify, because you mentioned this earlier, that the fact that we now even have this problem to consider and to ponder is also sort of shedding light on the fact that we do have now this possibility.
Yeah.
It's like the problem poses the possibility in a way that we wouldn't have been able to see before.
Definitely. And it's also, I think, yeah, nothing could be further from, I think, the attitude of this particular book. Maybe some other Jameson books are more kind of pensive. But this particular book, you know, like, it just says, yeah, okay, there is a climate catastrophe. You know, we have all these bad things happening. And we have this literature that's not quite, someone who was like raised in this tradition of like French modernism. This is not French modernism, right? It reads Cloud Atlas at some point. This is not Mallarmé. It's not, couldn't be further. But it still, you know, like offers, you know, even if it is kind of different and changing and symptomatic of these other changes, we should, and that's a big thing, is that things are symptoms. They appear to us not as just portents of doom, right? They are symptoms of what's going on underneath. Mm. We can detect those things. We can see the good premise of postmodernism is that the still good, the thing that still holds good, not the old man mad at building part of postmodernism. The good part of postmodernism, the book, is that there's the counterflows of history as an economic and perhaps like a collective reality that underlies the phenomenon of, you know, postmodern literature, postmodern architecture, particular cultural configuration that we receive. So obviously pessimism is kind of existent and it's bad, but it's also kind of Jameson definitely sees it as a kind of a starting off point. Why isn't utopia present? Why are we so consumed by these teenage dystopias? Why are we just, you know, why does everyone know Hunger Games better than the Ursula Le Guin, right? That kind of thinking.
Yeah.
Why is that? Because these other thinkers, they provide a kind of an alternative. And in fact, you know, even dystopias within them, you know, there is a kind of a utopia. And for Jameson, everything has a utopian dimension, even racism. Racism has a utopian dimension because it projects this collectivity of the race. It's not just a kind of and everything, like this is true for like the joke or the, you know, everything kind of contains within it the seed of utopia, which I think these big words like utopia, the communism, absolute, these are all kind of names for totality for Jameson, is that we can kind of, again, like we can tap in or see the totality present, even if we can't, you know, write it down.
So really quick on this note, because I think you're hitting on something really key. His name hasn't come up, but this is also very reminiscent of Ernst Bloch's kind of idea that every sort of form of life, every way of thinking does have this sort of utopian dimension, and you can analyze and interpret things as a way to discover what that is. So saying that even racism itself has this utopian dimension is just to acknowledge the fact that, yeah, like everything does in some sort of way.
Yeah, and another thing that, this is in this book only, I think. I haven't really seen it ever elsewhere in Jameson. He kind of substitutes the ultimate determining instance. He doesn't really talk about economic in this book. He talks about the collective. And this is really the kind of the materialism. When he talks about materialism, he talks about how we are all determined by this kind of idea of collective being. Like we're all determined by ultimately like every aspect of like social being as an ontic reality is produced by this desire, or the desire to live with others and the desire to construct a kind of collective living together, of which economy is a part. Like, you know, economy is the organization, the administration of collective living. And all kind of thought can be, you know, like everything that's written is definitely written to project into the world. So even like the most nihilistic works, they still presume a kind of a collectivity and a collective and a way of collective being that receives the readership. You know, like even the most, you know, Unabomber manifesto stuff, it also like presumes a kind of a collective of like-minded beings that live together or understand each other and are able to communicate and act. So yeah, that's really for Jameson. That's why I think he still is a Marxist, but Marxism for him is a kind of an opening, a kind of a way, a clearing, a way to kind of pose a problem.
Hmm.
But it's a very, again, like his ultimate, I think, the determining instance for him is the collective, is the being together, the unrepresentable collective human totality.
So one thing really quick, I know that, you know, you brought your copy of The Political Unconscious. And whenever we first talked about doing this book, you said this, you see this as sort of a follow-up to The Political Unconscious. So would you maybe say that this clearing to be able to think about the totality or the collective, like, how would you relate that to this sort of fourth level in Jameson's idea of the political unconscious? And how is that almost as if there is always this element of like the totality of the unconscious, and like what we're trying to do is figure out a way to describe that or analyze that or bring that into how we interpret works of literature and art and aesthetics, things like that?
I think the method that he provides, the allegorical and the four level structure, is a way of doing that. It's definitely like, again, like he's much more in this book focused on a kind of a whitehead almost. It's about process, it's about doing. It's about the doing of creating these connections between a possible, here's how you actually produce a theory of history out of any book, right? You can actually like produce a philosophy of history out of any work, because, you know, as long as you apply this interpretive code, you can kind of unfold it until this full anagogical dimension. Right? There is a kind of a, any work kind of projects or unfolds or telescopes out into this gyre of yeats, you know, like it's just like kind of. Yeah, like a book, like literally, like almost figuratively, like explodes into the world that it projects. And in Yeats, there's this weird thing of like the way you create the gyre, you have to, a god has to impregnate a woman. Or Yeats had this metaphysics of like, you know how like in the, yeah, like the ever widening gyre of the beast slouching into Bethlehem. Like the gyre was the, he had this theory of like everything in the world actually is born out of these gyres, which are like big tornadoes or whatever. And the way you create one, or the way it begins, is that someone gets impregnated.
Someone just bangs? Yeah. God bangs?
Usually a god, yeah, like Zeus or impregnation, or like the conception of Jesus, that kind of thing. Anyway, but like the Jamesonian idea is that I think that you can explode a kind of a philosophy of history out of any work, because again, like it presumes this collective dimension at the highest level. Whether or not this is like good or not, his argument is actually, yes, it, you have to kind of, because we need to think historically, we need to think kind of in terms of, and thinking historically as meaning like not historicism, not just like, oh, what's the historical context of this work, but how does this kind of create possible, how does this think the utopian, how does this produce the utopian society?
Soccer.
That's right, soccer. In the response to Ahmad's essay, essentially like the sort of post-colonialism, the nation debate, Jameson offers a kind of a, I would say a slightly like rambling kind of response in that it has like several parts that aren't really related. But there is a kind of an interesting question of how to think the collective on this level of, if you're just a person in India or in a third world country, how do you think, how do you actually like act and think of the national? And it's a difficult problem, and it runs into all these questions that we talked about of the representability of the collective. And for Jameson, again, this is the big problem of that you can't write the collective, you can't put it into a single voice. So for Jameson, this is the big problem of like the inability to write the collective or to figure the collective except through these allegories. And one of these interesting like ideas is that soccer offers a way of thinking about the collective. It offers a way of thinking about capitalism and the global and the national in this really kind of cute way. And in a way that actually most people would understand,
yeah,
which is that every player and every person actually, like most of the world, like starts playing soccer kind of on the street or with friends, you know, kind of maybe on a kind of improvised field. And then there's this process of like selection, is that when you are like five or six, everyone, if you're not very well to do, you know, in the third world country, like, or a second world country, like kind of developing country like Brazil, you are kind of thinking, oh, you know, I could be the next Ronaldo or the next Messi. And so you kind of go to, scouts will kind of gather around and figure out who is more promising or less. People, the well-to-do will be able to kind of put out their own, you know, find a coach, find a team, find a field that you would play on. And the more poorer kids will be playing in the streets and so on. And slowly this process kind of bifurcates the city, the modern city, at least bifurcates, maybe more splitting. But at the very least, there usually emerges a team, a kind of the working class, and the team of kind of the well-to-do. This is kind of a split in every like locality, is that like the better off manage to kind of create their own kind of ecosystem of soccer, and the poorer people kind of manage to create their own. And then eventually they kind of clash in these entities of teams, local teams. There will be a well-to-do team and a kind of not well-to-do team. And that's the rivalry usually in big cities. In Latin America, there's two teams. You know, sometimes it happens on religious grounds. Like in Glasgow, there's two teams. There's Rangers and there's Celtic. In Edinburgh, there's two teams. There's Hearts and there's Hibs. And they are, there are also like class divisions kind of embodied in those things. And then what happens is that the richer team typically has more resources, and they buy the best players of the poorer team or like shop elsewhere, and they get better. And they get better, and their stadium gets bigger, and their like receipts get better, and they get better and better. And eventually, they kind of become a kind of a national entity. They become like in each country, there is a best team, or the top five teams. There is like a usually a, quite a small number. It becomes very quickly monopolized into two or three teams that dominate every year, year in, year out. Very rare for there to be like a, an upset in this kind of system. And usually the upset comes when other capital comes in. So that kind of happens within a country. Then globally, European countries, the richest countries, the countries where capital kind of flows to, they purchase the players, the kind of the best talent in the world. They shop around. The scouting system kind of you know, funnels them all down to the teams in England, in Spain, in Italy, in Germany. And that's where they play. That's where the like the best players come around. And that's like the system, the global system of club sport in soccer, is that this is like the kind of funneling.
Mm-hmm.
And it happened quite, you know, quickly. Almost, you know, it's a very modern phenomenon. It's not like, it's not even 19th century. It happened last couple of decades, last few decades of sport, like kind of the funneling happened almost, yeah, like a few decades ago, like the world funneling of the best players. In the 50s, like, you wouldn't expect someone from Argentina to really come to, like, you know, travel all the way. Maybe some, maybe a few players, but it would require a lot of effort. Today, it's almost automatic. If you're really good, you want to play for Barcelona. You don't want to play for, I guess if you're in Argentina, you don't want to play for River. You don't want to play for Boca. You know, you want to play for them for a bit, but then you want to go to Spain's, Italy's, the Europe. But nonetheless, they retain a connection to the original, kind of to the country of origin, which is that they retain a connection to a national team where they have to compete every 4 years or every 2 years in national competitions. And it kind of creates this weird dynamic of like someone like Messi is almost universally at this point loathed in his country of origin,
mm-hmm.
because they all hate him because he left and, you know, ruined, probably, like, he left at a very early age, but he could have been like the great player at any of their teams. So he's not very grateful to Argentina. And every time he comes back, there's this great expectation of him because he's the greatest player of the modern era to do very well for Argentina, to do, like, you know, at least bring them a trophy. And as he's kind of aging, is, and there are reasons why Messi's aging faster than everyone else, is because of the treatments he received when he was a kid. He's probably never going to win them, like, the great trophy, the biggest trophies, like the World Cup. And there's this great resentment of him as a player because he, you know, he's not giving his all, or he didn't like stay in Argentina where he could like actually learn with the Argentinian players, and then he would be like a much more cohesive unit with other players.
Mm-hmm.
And there's that, yeah, great like kind of hatred of him, like he is, you know, not liked in his native country. This is also true for a lot of like English players, is that not because they leave, most English players stay, but because they play for rival teams. So like Rooney played for United, and he was not liked because of it, because United were kind of a loathed team. And because he was kind of a loathed individual, and because he didn't do that well for England, even though he was probably the greatest player of his generation, you never won anything, and he always kind of didn't perform quite as well as people expected him to. So for Jameson, this thing is kind of like fairly basic. Like, even, you know, if you have any familiarity with soccer, you kind of know. But for him, this is a way of kind of seeing the national, or seeing how national is lived in the world of capitalism. Is that capitalism has this kind of attractive force that pulls people into like countries. Like the brain drain is usually basically this, is that
yeah.
you kind of drain together. But it also retains a kind of these national forms, like the national team in soccer, are still around. They're still there. They're still present, even though there's no reason for them to do this. Like, there's no real kind of, at least in the rationality of capitalism, there's no reason for you to go and spend like 3 months every 4 years to go play in the World Cup, get injured, you know, and lose anyway, you know. And the World Cup is a kind of a symbolic thing because you were trained in Barcelona, you were trained in Spain, you were like raised in Spain. Barcelona procured the human growth hormone treatments for you. You were like assembled in Spain, basically. Mm-hmm. But now you have to go to this other country that hates you and go to this thing that, you know, you're very unhappy about. Why is this still happening? And that's kind of the imagination, I think, is that there is a pull. There is a kind of a real, in some sense, maybe ethnic or linguistic, there's some sort of pull of the like kind of the country. And Jameson, again, like grounds this in this determination of the collective, is that the nation offers you a way of thinking the collective in a way that capitalism doesn't. Capitalism does not offer you a way of thinking the collective. And in fact, it kind of erases this sort of thinking. It kind of fractures it further. It makes it very abstract. It's very hard to say that like a conglomerate like Barcelona that's owned partially by the Middle Eastern monarchies, like by a Qatar, is Spanish or Catalan in any way. Instead, it's kind of like it's not really owned by anyone. It's just kind of floating. Whereas the nation is a nation. It's a geographical entity, and it has a real presence in a way that perhaps capital things don't, you know. And in much the same way, I think anyone like living in the third world, you do actually like have this sort of understanding of the nation that's not there for the first world. Is that you do always kind of think of the national allegory, is that in literature, you think of like, for Jameson, whenever someone writes like a story in the third world, that's a kind of a realistic story. It always also poses this question of the third world kind of domination by the first world.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever someone is kind of writing a story of like a character being oppressed, it's a story of the third world domination over the first world domination. And obviously, the response to this idea is that it's orientalizing. It's always orientalizing because, you know, you're a first world person. This domination of the third by the first is always the first thing that you turn to, and that's the only lens through which you can view it. And for Jameson, again, like, this is for him, like, for the first world kind of literary critic, this is like a lens, or like an opportunity. Like, this is a way to think the collective, to think the, for both the third world writer and the first world reader, this is a way to kind of think of history and access it in this collective dimension of determination. Is that, yes, there was a kind of a time of domination. And what does that mean? And what does that produce today? And the conclusions are much the same, is that, you know, there must be a kind of an interpretation and understanding that's global in this way, in the global in the way of being able to access the dimension of the collectivity. But it cannot be a kind of universalizing first world understanding, because this, you can never fully kind of remove the lens of Orientalism. But that's the sport offers this sort of way of thinking of the collective that you wouldn't necessarily be able to.
I think it's pretty obvious too that whenever we look at the sort of function of nationalism now as a sort of reactionary response to the hegemonic domination of global capital, it would make a lot of sense that what's being posed is sort of this very concrete, sort of intuitive way to think about the collective, precisely as a response to a sort of limitation of capital and being able to think about collectives in that way. Yeah, it's really interesting, because I think that whenever we talk about nationalism and sort of why is the engine of history restarted, and why is it that there are these certain kind of very reactionary formations against capital, it seems like that's kind of underneath, like, part of what's happening here. It's a sort of struggle about how to think about the collective in this particular context.
Yeah, this is definitely true. But at the same time, Jameson, I think at this point, kind of fully integrated the thesis of someone like Benedict Anderson, mm-hmm. or Tom Nairn. Benedict Anderson's proposition in the Imagined Communities is something like, even though nationalism is a very kind of dangerous thing, or can be very dangerous, the particular, like, figuration of nationalism, the kind of thinking of togetherness, very rarely is kind of violent. It's mm-hmm. usually a kind of a, comes from a place of common injury or something. And it's hard to say that it's reactionary, like, as such, because for Anderson, and I think for Jameson also, this is, it touches on this idea of collectivity and group thinking. And nationalism is really the first way of kind of thinking about it, like, in this way, in the original way. And it's really powerful. And I don't think, like, Jameson would agree that it's universally, like, negative.
Yeah.
And I think in saying that it is a kind of response to capitalism, that's a common refrain, I think. But it's also, I think, quite close to these theories of false consciousness, is that, well, people just are, you know, racist or nationalist because mm-hmm. taxes are high or whatever, like, or because they lost their jobs, and that's what happens. That might be true on the level, again, like, on some level of interpretation, that might be true. But there's another one, which is that, yes, it is. There is a kind of utopia in it, even though you could say that it's misguided in some sense. But it's also a very effective way of collective being. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you have to confront it as such. You can't just say, like, well, you're just wrong, you know, like, or, you know, we have to substitute a better response, you know, which you probably do at some point. You have to kind of see it as a different way. But there is no clear, you know, it doesn't work very well when you try. It doesn't work very well when you try to substitute a progressive nationalism. It doesn't work very well when you try to just focus on class politics, you know. There's something there. There's something like a real question there. And you shouldn't conflate. There's another thing, which is that conflating, that's a big thing of Jameson, is that you shouldn't conflate the levels. You shouldn't conflate the levels of class struggle and the political. It's that the class struggle is at the kind of, for him at least, at the kind of a lower level. It's this kind of what happens in the workplace and what happens. It doesn't confer a kind of a political identity. So, like, the political situations are much more varied, and responses have to be kind of clever. You can't just, like, again, like, you can't just project a kind of, well, workers are on this side, bosses are on this side, workers are always, like, progressive and want this.
Yeah.
But anyway, these are, like, difficult problems that he doesn't really confront in the book, but he does talk about, like, how this is a way, a different way of thinking about it. On the other hand, nationalism in power, like, there's kind of a nationalism of, like, of thinking of the nation, of the collective figuration, that kind of thing. But there is a nationalism in power, nationalism as a state, as an arm of the state, and that's a different kind of question. And for Jameson, that's not progressive.
I think even the idea that there could be these two ways to interpret nationalism is sort of like, yeah, very, maybe a very sort of generative initial way to think about the collective versus nationalism as attached to the state and power. The fact that there are even two different ways to think about that is, again, not part of many discussions I've ever, you know, encountered about the role of nation, especially in the realm of the political on the left. So
one thing is the term that I kind of forgot to mention is this. It's from Ibn Khaldun. It's called asabiyya. It's a kind of a group or clan identity. And Jameson kind of, I don't know why, but like he forefronts, again, like this ability to think collectively and in kind of a fused way, in a way of a group is sort of precious. And it's a way of, again, like for political action is to access or tap into this. And nationalisms are a type of thinking, a collective thinking, and a fused thinking that is very hard to defeat. Or like, you know, if you just confronted it as a kind of an object that's there that you have to kind of overcome. I don't think there are many very successful ways of overcoming it. Again, like Catalonia perhaps is a good example of like, oh, there are like social democratic parties there that try to do this thing of like playing both sides of trying to kind of appease them a little bit, you know, give them home rule a little bit, but it doesn't work. You can't defeat like nationalism on the plane of nationalism with just saying like, well, we'll just give you more subsidies or whatever. And obviously it's complicated by the fact that in the EU, how can you be like a full nationalist if you still want to retain the kind of the EU structure? Because that doesn't mean borders. It doesn't mean, anyway, it is a kind of a strange and difficult question. And I don't think Jameson will provide an answer, but he would provide a kind of an interpretive shift.
Yeah.
In this way.
So you said there was one other thing outside of soccer you wanted to touch on. So I think that maybe would be the last big piece, right?
I think this is it. I think that would be pretty much it. I wanted to talk about the Asabia and like how, you know, yeah, the group figuration is very different from individual. And that's really like the goal of the work is to foment or create a group thinking or a thinking that can eventually produce group action.
One of the things I always like to touch on is any particular criticisms or weaknesses in the text that you saw that you wish there would have been more of this or sort of a different perspective that you had. Was there anything in particular that you found yourself being very critical of as you read through?
Well, less Edmund Spencer, less Fairy Queen, less, you know, probably less Hamlet. I don't know. Like, but more like seriously, I think there's a real kind of lacuna in Jameson, a very like deliberate omission of any ethical dimension. Mm. And for him, like any ethical is ideological in this bad sense of like, oh, it's just like a kind of it's an operation that's of repression or attempt to kind of, yeah, it kind of moves from the ethical to the political very quickly.
He also mentioned too that four-level interpretive schema, that the initial kind of variation of that, I think you said in record, was that third level was the moral. Is that part of why you see Jameson shifting away from moral per se to more psychoanalytic? Is him sort of sidestepping that issue?
Yeah, I mean, throughout the work of Jameson, there is a kind of a repression, you could say, or just an omission of the moral. The third level in the classical sense is always the moral, but in Jameson, it's existential or psychoanalytic or, you know, psychological, kind of pertaining to the individual consciousness. And the moral generally is not really considered in this way. I think there is an ethic you could kind of determine of like, well, you know, collective action is better, you know, utopia is better than non-utopia. You can kind of recode everything in a way that has a kind of a normative dimension, but it's not a properly ethical dimension because it doesn't bear upon the ethical kind of virtue or the good life or a particular judgment of action and so on. It's not ethics of, it's an ethics of something. It's kind of you know, it's an intentionalist ethic. There is something like that, but there's nothing like an ethics. There's nothing like a kind of an action is good for, this action is good or this action is better. This particular way of life is better as such. That's a very deliberate thing. It's not I called it a lacuna, but really it's a move. He deliberately says that this is not something I'm interested in. Mm-hmm. This is always blindly kind of ideological in a bad sense. You are always kind of this fracturing of the world into good and bad behavior or something is just a work of the consciousness. And it's a projection from the beginning of kind of pleasure and pain. You kind of split that into like virtue and non-virtue or good and bad. And then you produce a kind of ideology of the ethical. I don't know if you can say like this is an error or something. I don't think that you can say that, but it is a kind of a move that I don't really agree with. I think there is a kind of an ethical dimension to life that Jameson kind of omits or deliberately kind of displaces. Mm-hmm. I also think that there is a kind of it's not an optimism, but there is a kind of almost a manifesto thinking, is that like, because it's theory and it's not philosophy, he doesn't really talk about how to resolve these issues and riddles of consciousness and of subjectivity, interpretation, and so on. These things appear to him as kind of like clever little puzzles on the way towards text production and text interpretation, is that like, these are the aporias that arise. Here's how you kind of subvert them or divert them, or just like comment on lightly on them. And we're moving on because it's a secondary discipline. You're commenting on texts, on cultural happenings. You're not grappling with these problems. And this can be sidestepped because there will always be a kind of a second thing. There will always be a second coming in the tradition, is that someone will produce a Marxist text on which you can comment on. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, there will be another book to comment on. There's no closed-endedness to it. And it's not a philosophical system because of it, because it doesn't begin, and it doesn't end. At some point, he talks about like how the fact that there are beginnings and ends is the cornerstone or the beginning of ideology. It's to posit that there is a beginning and there is an end, that's ideology, because you know you are omitting all of everything else. You're kind of bracketing. The phenomenological bracketing is an ideological kind of move. And if you are kind of accepting that there is no beginning and end, and there's no like real first principle, and there's no real like moment of real kind of contestation, if you dialectically absorb every other position, you can never like contradict it. You can never say like, oh, you're wrong. Oh, no, I'm not wrong. You were wrong because this is symptomatic of what you were doing. You know, like you fit into my interpretive system, which I can always absorb a contrary position into me.
Mm.
And this is a kind of a lot of criticism of postmodernism, the book, from a kind of a pro-leotard and pro, I guess, deconstructionist side, where that, you know, if you approach the world in this dialectical way, where dialectics and reification are not just tools or are things, but they are cornerstones of thinking, you can never be wrong. Right, you can always be late or something, or like, you know, you can always be like unfortunate in saying something, but you're always like retroactively correct, because you can always integrate it into a larger scheme of being. Like, you can always say, oh yeah, well, when I said postmodernism, what I really meant is postmodernity, and it's because at this time, this is literally what he says, at that time I didn't know that, you know, like postmodernism, the style would disappear, but instead the like the underlying essence will continue. I mean, you know, it just means I'm not wrong, you know. I was just not aware of future. You know?
Yeah.
I was just not prescient.
I wasn't at this particular place at the time I said that.
Yeah. No, but like literally for him, it's like the reason why like postmodernism as a style of architecture like ended, because it did. He didn't predict the end of it. He predicted that it will continue in some way, and it ended. So he was kind of, if he was like empirically contradicted by events, it's only because, you know, he wasn't aware that this other future was coming. Like, it wasn't a mistake, because he wasn't aware that this thing would happen, because otherwise he would just integrate it. So it's kind of like reverse Hegelian determinism, is that like, oh yeah, you know, the future is determined by the present. You know, if there is a human nature and it's destroyed or whatever, or if there is a kind of a style and it's ended, it was already predetermined in the past. Like, it is retroactively determinist.
Yeah.
Determinism kind of going, it's a determinism of the Angelus Novus, right? You're a determinist in the way that you're always looking at the past, and the past always appears to you as a predetermined thing. And that's really nice, right? That's a really nice thing to say. But if you were to say that to someone who's like a scientist, I'm like, oh yeah, I wasn't wrong. It's just that, you know, the conditions told me that this is right. And, you know, and then later on, the conditions developed that I wasn't right. Oh, look at this. I have a new model that incorporates these things. And my new position actually is a part of the old position. And you can kind of constantly slightly modify these things. And this is a kind of an indictment of both Sartre, I think, and Adorno, and a lot of thinkers that are kind of central to Jameson, is that you can always, like, if you're thinking dialectically in the sense, you can always modify your position slightly so that it incorporates the opponent position. And you can always kind of retroactively be true, like, or correct, or true to the moment. And if, you know, again, like, if you use this excuse that you are just reading symptomatics, you also can never be wrong, because your, you know, writing is also symptomatic. You can never be, you know, like, there's never falsification, there's never contestation, there's only, like, words, I guess, that appear. It kind of does become this question of, like, traces and clearings, and it does appear to be ontological. It kind of falls into this problem of, well, what are you saying? What are you actually saying? Can you actually like produce an action out of it if it's never wrong? If someone like interprets you to say this and they act accordingly and it fails, well, that's just, you know, that's just what happens. You know, there's no crucible of action. There's no crucible of the revolution. You know, even though the text kind of has like this manifesto-like quality, no one has ever like read Jameson and went and did a revolution. You know, that's never happened before. And they're not going to be. And so there is a kind of both, even though it kind of condemns these philosophies of reflection, it actually is less brave in a way than a lot of philosophy of the reflection. Mm. Like someone like Ricoeur at least says like, well, here's what I think the proper like understanding of time is. And Jameson would say, here's what a historically motivated understanding of time is at this time, right? Like at this particular juncture, our late modernity created this object, and this is how you can read it allegorically as this other thing. You know, that's nice. Again, like this is a good, interesting point to make, but it's not true. Like it's not like, or it cannot be assessed as true or false. But that's also a category mistake, because it's not a work of philosophy. So you can't really say like, oh yeah, it's not really correct or reflecting a correct thing. So because it already has these inbuilt protections against this, it cannot be falsified. It cannot be, you know, reproach for anything anyone else does.
That would make a lot of sense, too, about sort of, like you said, the kind of sidestepping or inclusion of the problem of ethics as well. Yeah. Like, those feel very related, that if you, that's not necessarily what you're interested in, or you're not necessarily tackling the ethical dimension, it would make a lot of sense that that would be, in some ways, like kind of symptomatic of this particular sort of way of approaching texts.
Yeah, if you are not responsible for anything, or have this kind of attenuated responsibility that's almost like, oh, that's interesting, well, here's the response to it, right? Like, if everything is like that, then ethics does fall out. Like, it's just, there's no ethics. For all the pretensions of the ethics of writing or whatever, you know, Derrida or whatever, it at least posits something like an ethics, or at least like gestures towards it. And I don't know, like, that's kind of the end of it. Is really like, the problem is it's not an error, because he deliberately created this category where this is an error is excluded from.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, this is, so what is it then? Like, what is... I'm not even sure if an objection, like, he could never write a book that would be different that I'm suggesting. Like, there could never be a book of Jamesonian philosophy, because he's not a philosopher. There could not be a book of Jamesonian science, because he's not a scientist. So it just is what it is. It is, you know, a work of text interpretation, production of sentences, analysis of sentences. It has this kind of, I guess, a vector built into it of, here's how you should be doing it. It is a part of the tradition, the hermeneutic tradition, that uses these concepts, if they can be called concepts, and eventually something happens, something like, but it is, for all the pretensions of like, well, there's going to be a constructive action at the end of it, it is reflexive. Like, there is only, and reflexive and reflective, like it's pertaining to reflection, and the practice of itself is a kind of reflexive practice, is you just then sit and read and write.
So I guess sort of reading Jameson and knowing the kind of limitations of the approach and what it's doing and what it's not necessarily aiming to do, it's just something to keep in mind if you are going to read Jameson. It's just, you know, be aware you're not looking for a sort of concrete political manual of how to overthrow global capital necessarily when you're reading him.
Well, he does actually have writing that is like, well, here's what you should be doing. Mm. And he does actually have this sort of, so I feel like that's not really true. Like, it's not really true that he doesn't have practical prescription. It's that these works, which are quite rare, I think, in Jameson oeuvre. Another thing, if you pick up a book by a Marxist literary critic, like at random, there's like 0% chance that it's a book of Marxist literary criticism.
Yeah.
Because it's always about television or about politics or about like what's going on at the moment. It's almost never like a book. So this is a kind of rare in Jamesonian oeuvre that you actually pick up a book that says Marxist literary criticism. It is a work of Marxist literary criticism.
Yeah, that's what it is, yeah.
And like, I think that someone... In Raymond Williams's bibliography, there's two books of criticism. There's a book on drama and there's a book on novel. And that's it. And there's like 20 books that are like interviews and political writings and writings on television and so on. So same thing as Jameson. I think there's like two books of literary, like kind of methodological stuff, which is that, well, I guess three, this counts also. So Allegory, Political Unconscious, and Antinomies of Realism. And then there's three-ish books of like... literary interpretation of like case studies. The book on Wyndham Lewis, the book on Sot, and the book on Chandler, kind of a book on Chandler. And the rest are kind of like not that at all and don't really pertain to literary criticism, you know, as a discipline. That's not what Harold Bloom does when he writes his thing. But yeah, he does have political writing. It's not like, I'm not faulting it for not having a political dimension.
Yeah, sure.
I am faulting it for kind of displacing it, kind of making it into, again, like a ruse of interpretation, is that like everything is kind of a hermeneutic. Every action is opens this telescopical, allegorical, and hermeneutic dimension. When do you actually act? Like when does that come? When do you put down Hamlet? You know, and it does kind of sound facile. And his response is obvious, is that this is not what I'm doing. This is clearly inbuilt. But at some point you have to act, which is what the book is about, I think, is, or like the constructivist stuff is meant to kind of cut the knot, you know, like let's accept all these things and let's still produce things. Let's still produce and do things.
So what books of his do have that sort of dimension of the act, if someone were to want to check those out as well?
I think if you read like Ideologies of Theory, actually, if you read the Book of Interviews, the first question is about, he really hates the question. He like spends like 3 pages answering. But the question is what I said, basically, is that like, why are we reading Balzac when we should be acting? Like, why are we spending another book writing about, you know, if you're really a revolutionary, why are you doing this? And he kind of goes like, well, this is a category mistake, you know, because understanding, you know, of things in the world is much like understanding of literary. And, you know, he kind of goes through and he unfolds what he thinks the political actual dimension is. And he's kind of annoyed by the interview. Like every time he's giving an interview, he's really annoyed. There's an introduction to the book, which is like, I fucking hate interviews. You know, like every time people talk about interviews, it's like this dimension of like, oh yeah, there's like people talking about ideas, you know, like ideas which are like flavors or like types of clothes that you put on. You know, like, oh yeah, the idea of like, you know Philosophy Bites, the podcast?
Oh, I do. Yeah, very well.
That's the view of like, oh yeah, you know, here's consequentialism. Here is, you know, anyway, terrible. But like...
fucking shots fired at Philosophy Bites.
Nigel Warburton, whatever. Yeah. Fucking asshole. Who was the guy? Alan de Bottom or whatever, like
Alain de Botton.
Alain de Bottom. That guy. It's Nigel Warburton and that guy are the same guy. Like
it's they are
like,
very similar, yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah, I can't remember what episode it was on, but we did mention fucking both of them and like people in that vein, and we have universal loathing for them. So yeah.
Terrible. And like that's the cheapening and the commodification of thought. And this is the most Adorno that Jameson ever gets, is that like you are just like, you know, flattening these ideas. You have to like work through these problems, actually like figure out what's going on, present the actual situation of the problem, and then you are like understanding the philosophical essence. You can't just like say, oh, here's an idea, here's a cool idea that fucking Descartes thought of. That's stupid. But like, what would be the use? Anyway, like, it's just a way to get jobs. And like, it used to be a way to get jobs on French television. It's just you were like able to kind of say something cool. Anyway.
I feel like it's you read things like that to just get you through the flight that you're on because you picked up a book airport bookstore. Yeah.
Get through Philosophy 101, you know.
Yeah.
But those criticisms, he kind of understands. You can't like, that's another thing. You can't like catch him unaware. He understands all of this. Like this is, he knows everything that there is to know about this. So he would respond and then you would respond. And then, you know, like, so that's really the way to kind of confront this position is that, well, it's not really that I'm advocating decisionism in any way. It's just that, you know, this is necessary in the current moment and so on. So again, like you can't really criticize. This problem is that you can't land a punch because it's always like you're always shifting. But again, like it's interesting. And that's the thing that he talks about, like what matters is interest. What matters really more than truth is that something is interesting. It's something like it kind of tickles you in a certain way. It produces a kind of a, not a feeling, because feelings are the ultimate kind of ideological tool of like pseudo like biological or pseudo psychological theory. But there is something like an arousal of interest. Something happens when an interesting way of speaking or presenting a problem arises. And that something kind of interrupts everything else. It kind of, it shifts the conceptual idea. Mm-hmm. He used a lot of Kuhn. He would talk about like, really, I think it literally is just about the idea of the paradigm shift. But the fact that you can kind of shake the web, like a stone can fall onto the spider web and shake the whole thing, is what happens kind of when a new way, an interesting way is introduced. For Jameson, that's what really matters, is that like, even if Deleuze is not right about everything, here's an interesting thing that Deleuze said about time. Even if Gramos, you know, had these pretensions, or people who followed Gramos had all these pretensions about semiotics as a science, here's why like the semiotic square is still useful. Even if Hegel had this kind of all these like insane things about the absolute spirit, and the last chapter of Phenomenology of Spirit is garbage, even then you still have kind of all these things that are there that you can use.
Yeah.
And that's the thing, is that on the front of Archaeologies of the Future, Terry Eagleton, it's a strange thing, it's like it's supposed to be on the back but it's on the front, it says this is a treasure trove of a book. It's a treasure trove of like of criticism. And that's not a compliment. I wouldn't want to call my book a treasure trove. I don't like that, because that's like a box full of, you know, trinkets.
Well, it's almost looking at the ideas as these commodified things that you can then, like pick up and have.
Yeah, I would not like being in time is not a treasure trove, you know.
It's the fucking opposite. Yeah. It's whatever the opposite of it is, that's what that book is.
Yeah, a philosophical system is not a treasure trove. You can't come in, open it, and pick stuff out. But for Jameson, I think the collective intellectual endeavor is something like a treasure trove. It's something like this eclecticism, very deliberate, systematic eclecticism. That's really the system, is that you can actually kind of, on basis of interest, you can pick out things that you like are interesting or useful, and you can kind of feel the pulse of the cultural, like, you know, and apply these things as it's, you know, as it come is fit. And the only thing that matters is this kind of commitment to a particular viewpoint and a particular reading. In the end, there is a sort of a voluntarism to it, is that like these were kind of arbitrary, ideologically kind of maybe caused in some way, symptomatic decisions, but they are like quite eclectic decisions about what goes. The world, intellectual world, is a treasure trove of things, of cool, interesting artifacts, And there's also the garbage heap of things that aren't very good. But, you know, you can kind of, in the, you know, mountains of shit, you can pick out these little diamonds. And that's the job of the theorist, is that you, much like in the art world, you know, there's a ton of dung, you pick out little, you know, diamonds. You also pick out those things in the constellations of ideas. And eventually you kind of, history happens. And you terraform the earth.
Yeah, and you escape the earth, Anthropocene. Yeah. Well, so maybe on that note, feels like a good natural wrapping up point. I guess, Comrade Marvin, I'll say again, you've lived up to my promise. Oh, yeah, you did not fall ungracefully from the pedestal. So I thought that was about as a great of a sort of tackling of Jameson I could have imagined.
All right. Well, I guess I'll see.
How'd you feel about it?
I'm pretty good. Yeah, I'm ready to like submerge myself in the flow of being and. Pretty good.
Is that what you're going to do after we're done recording?
That's right.
You're going to go?
In the foam of spirit. Yeah. Spirit is Miller Light. Or no, it's going to be Lone Star.
I was going to say, is it Bud Light foam, with some ice cubes in it?
Oh, yeah. Shout out Mikey Miles 15 on Instagram. That's my Instagram account.
That's you? That's actually right. Who you are?
Yeah. Yep.
I guess, would you ever want to come on and do another book? Another episode?
Sure. Yeah.
All right, because I feel like I'm definitely going to ask you.
All right, sweet.
On that note, comrade listeners, go digest everything in this episode. Right. Consider, ponder. If you had to recommend one Jameson book to start with, would it be the Book of Interviews?
It would be The Science of Logic by G.A.W.F. Hegel.
Okay, you heard that. That is our official position. If you want to understand Jameson, read Science of Logic. All right. All right, y'all. We'll catch y'all next time. Comrade Marvin, thanks for being here.
All right. Wa salam.
All right, y'all. See you next week. All right, that does it for this week. Big shout out to Comrade Marvin for coming on, for not crashing and burning off of his pedestal that I've placed him on, and leading us through a discussion of Fredric Jameson's Allegory and Ideology and his overall project and approach to Marxist literary criticism, to theory, and the importance of thinking the collective, the totality. For future episodes of this My Gott
Pure Ideology
series that we're doing on Red Library, we're going to be tackling works by a lot of the people that Comrade Marvin mentioned today, people like Terry Eagleton, his book on ideology. We're going to read a Slavoj Žižek book called The Sublime Object of Ideology, and probably a few other things. So expect to see those episodes coming up soon, probably sometime in March or April. Big shout out to all our comrade listeners across the globe. Big shout out to you. Thanks for listening. Thanks for tuning in each and every week for more icy cold motherfucking takes, spicy comments, liquid hot magma analysis, confused ramblings, incoherent musings, and all the other bullshit we spew each and every week from this terrifying platform we now occupy. Until we see you next Sunday, take care of yourselves out there. Stay hydrated, stay positive, stay active, stay revolutionary, stay radical, stay curious, and maybe stay confused. Sometimes staying confused is exactly the place you need to be. Keep sharing the show with your current comrades, future comrades, potential comrades, past comrades, and we'll see you back here next week for another broadcast out of the bunker that is the Red Library. We out here. Peace.